us with your Holy Spirit this morning, God. We magnify you, Lord. We lift you up, God, because you are worthy to be praised, God. We love you and we thank you. We worship you. In your precious name we pray. Amen.
Worthy. worship team. Awesome worship this morning. Amen. Yeah. Yeah, just a spirit of humility, a spirit of sincerity. And that's what God looks for, right? He doesn't resist that, does he? He doesn't resist a spirit of humility, a spirit of sincerity. But he does resist the proud, amen? That means he stands away from. It's the only, absolute, only time in Scripture where we see God standing away from somebody, distancing himself, not from the sinner, not from those who, you know, we would probably not even want to give the correct time to. It's not, it's the proud. It's the arrogant. He stands back from. And so I'm just so thankful that we have, I believe, a spirit of humility here. A spirit, you know, that says God, you know, like the Pharisee and the publican, you know, where they come into the temple both, and the Pharisee says, "Here I am, aren't you glad?" Basically, right? And the publican, the tax collector, says, "God, have mercy on me, I'm not worthy." That's us. That's us. God, we're not worthy, but you love us. And you do incredible things for us and in us. So we're thankful. Well, today we're beginning, and just to remind you about the offering, some have said, well, they don't take up an offering anymore. Woo-wee! Yeah, well, we really don't, and we're you know, a little hesitant about getting those long poles with the baskets on them. I mean, it could be done. And maybe in a safe way, then you just kind of, you know, do that. Oh, everybody, right? And just like the Pharisee, here it is. But what we're asking is we usually have an usher or two in the back at the end of service. You can put your offering there in the plate or send it in mail, electronically. A lot of folks have been doing that, so it's been good there. And so that's the way it's done. That's the way it's done for now. And amen. God blesses and blesses us for giving and being sacrificial. So we're talking about, we're getting into a series. It's October, we're coming up on Halloween and that kind of thing. So what better time than to talk about fear, right? And I want to tell you, you know, you may not notice it throughout your day and, you know, interacting with people. But I want to tell you, there is deep within many hearts a dread, an anxiety, a fear about where we are going. As a nation, as a people, there just is. People aren't really talking about it, but it is, you know, in most places, or maybe they are, I don't know. But a lot of times, it's the elephant in the room that nobody really wants to address. And neither should you start talking about politics and things like that necessarily, you know, with certain company, because that's, you know, where that goes, right? That's not always wise. But folks, there is really a deep-seated fear within, I believe, a spirit of fear within the people of this country. And not only fear, but whatever fear, you know, whatever its associates are, anxiety, worry, care, hate, bitterness, all of it. And so I can't think of a better time than to talk about what the Bible has to say about fear. If you have your Bibles, we're in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7, just that one verse to really start off this series. Fear not, fear not. It's been said that the aspect, or that phrase, depending on which translation you use, is mentioned and identified over 365 times in the Bible, where God or Jesus or the apostles tell us to fear not. You know what that is? That's one exhortation for every single day of the year. Just so happens. Fear not. Fear not. And folks, as I said, I can't think of a better time than now to be solidified in a trust in God like never before. That's not just a word now that we use, trust, reliance, dependence, but it is truly the condition of our heart that we are panting after God as the deer pants for the water. We thirst for him. We hunger for him. We need all that he has for us in this day and in this age. Amen? We need that. I think we all realize it. God is not calling you necessarily to do more for him. That's how you get to know him. But to be more for him. To be. To present yourself to him and say, God, here I am in all my ugliness, in all my shortcomings, in all of the things that I hate about myself. I can't even understand how you can even look at me because, you know, I tell you that I love you and then I go off and I do. And I say I'm never going to do that again and I go off and I do. You know, and all these things, God, I'm so fickle, but you love me. And you're committed to me. In every way, you're committed. And so that's the underlying principle that we want to ingrain ourselves with as we look at fear. As we look at fear. And so Paul says there in 2 Timothy, chapter 1, right off the bat, this is what he says to Timothy. He says, for God did not give us a spirit of fear, but of love and of power. I forgot how it went. You didn't have a spirit of fear, but of power and of love. And I like to use the translation that says sound mind. Yeah, sound mind. He did not give us a spirit of fear, but that of power and love, and of a sound mind. So let's take a look at why he's even writing this. He's writing it to who? Timothy, right? You would think that, okay, if it's called 1 Timothy and 2 Timothy, then he must be the author. But he's not, right? It's Paul encouraging his young protege. He is now in charge of a church, Timothy is. And he's got some insecurities. He really does, as many young ministers may, especially in this day and age. He's worried. He's timid. He's even probably been called a coward by some. And that's why Paul has to address Timothy, the young man, and say, listen, step up, stand up. Be encouraged because God's not given you a spirit of fear or timidity or cowardness or any of the other things that, you know, that kind of mean that same thing. But he has rather given you a spirit of power and of love and of a sound mind. Timothy was worried about how this church is going to go, who was going to beat up on him. There were older members there that probably were in the Lord longer than he. How do I tell them what to do? Timothy was worried about the fact that what if my life ends up, what if this church doesn't go well? What if I'm apprehended? What if I'm persecuted? What if I end up in jail just like Paul is? Can I handle that? A lot of insecurities going on in this young pastor's mind. And Paul says, I need to encourage you, Timothy, that God has called you and he's not given you a spirit of fear or intimidation. But power and love, self-discipline, or a sound mind. So we're going to talk about those three aspects. But before we do, I think it's important that we realize and understand how many of us know that there are really two different types of fears, basically. I mean, this phobia is like, you know, as many as you can count, probably. But there is what's called healthy fear, right? And unhealthy fear, simple as that. There is the fear that is healthy, the kind of fear that God has given and born within every human being, a type of fear. It protects us against what? Danger and threat, Will Robinson, right? Did you catch that? Some of you guys did, all right. That's a God-given gift. There are some things you need to be afraid of, right? God says, you know what? There are times when you need to fight or flight, right? You need to either fight or you need to flee. You need to go. You know, there's that instinct within you that helps you to do that. Now, the evolutionists would say that's because you used to be a chimpanzee and used to be, you know, a lower form of life, an animal, and that's what they did. No, God gave us that because it's wise sometimes to fight and sometimes to flee. Amen? It is wise sometimes to do that. So a healthy fear is good. I have healthy fears, I think. I'm afraid of the IRS. Okay? I'm afraid of electricity, John. I'm afraid of saw blades. Okay? I'm afraid of freakishly tall men. Brett, where are you? Right? I mean, that's those kinds of things, whether you call them fears or whether you call it like a respect, whether you call it some sort of a common sense, whatever it might be, those things are very necessary. They're very helpful in keeping you and I safe and even, in fact, alive, those kinds of fears. Okay? We're not talking about the other fear, and that's the fear that's unhealthy, an unhealthy fear. And we'll get to that in just a second, but there's also, I want to mention, there is a biblical fear that God says you must have. Anybody know what that is? The fear of God. Let me read. Proverbs 1:7. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge in this one. Knowledge. And that Hebrew word there means reverence. That fear or that reverence of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. I don't know about you, but when I first got saved, within a day or two of having that experience, that I know that I gave my heart to the Lord and I humbled myself, I began to see things more clearly. I couldn't do calculus any better or anything like that. Not that kind of wisdom and knowledge, okay? But I began to see the world and the rudiments of the world for what they were. There was like almost like an instant wisdom that came and rested on me that, you know what, wow. You begin to see the truth about, you know, motives. You begin to see the truth about, you know, agendas and things like that and people and systems and things like that. God just gives you a wisdom, a righteous wisdom. That's what this knowledge is here. David says also, in reverence I bow down. God wants that. God wants you to fear him and reverence him and bow down before him. Bible says, don't fear what man can do to you, right? Fear he who can kill the body and damn the soul to hell. That's what you fear. Man can't do anything. It's a win-win situation, folks. We don't like pain, and we certainly don't look forward to death and that kind of thing because, you know what, we don't like the means by which it happens a lot of times, the pain and the suffering or whatever like that. But you know what? It's a win-win situation. We live for Christ. To die is gain. To die is gain. And a wise heart and a knowledgeable heart of the Lord realizes that. That I'm just here for as long as I'm supposed to be here. And then I'm with him. So you know what? Don't, you know, I'm getting off the track a little here, but don't get all, you know, antsy and all disturbed about everything that's going on. First of all, there's nothing you can really do about it except pray. And be, you know, be the church, okay? Whatever. You know, God is working things toward what? His second coming. And he said these were the things that were going to happen, and we've talked about that. So don't get all in an uproar. God is bringing things to a head. God is doing what he's supposed to be doing, okay? And you know what? There may be times. Jesus said, in this life, you will have tribulation. There's going to be some pain, some heartache, hurt, sorrow, all the rest. There just will be. Many of the afflictions of the righteous, you know, the proverb says. But you know what? Guess what? It all ends good. It all ends up good. So, you know, just that's the bigger picture. That's the larger narrative, if you will, that we are in the hands of God. And he loves us. And all things truly will work together to the good, to them that are called by his purpose. Amen? All right, so that's what he says. And David says in Proverbs 9:10, Solomon adds this, the fear of the Lord is the beginning, and then you have wisdom. Wisdom, okay? Divine reverence slash fear, if you want to call it, is essential, folks. It is essential for you and I because it's the only way that we can truly know God. If you don't have a healthy reverence and a fear for God, you will not know Him. You cannot become intimate with Him. It's only when you humble yourself, first by receiving the gift of salvation that Jesus Christ, His Son, paid on the cross for you, redeemed you. And then you begin to grow in Him and you begin to study Him. You begin to treat God as if He's real by reading His Word and praying. As you begin to know Him, you begin to love Him. As you begin to reverence Him and honor Him in your life, He becomes close. He becomes near. There's no other way. We can't just, and God knows the heart. You can't just have a deep relationship with God just by coming here for an hour and a half on Sundays. It's a good thing, and everybody else will pat you on the back and say, wow, you are, wow, spiritual. You really are. But do you know God? Do you know God? Is it just a habit, a formality of coming here? Or have you, in fact, reverenced Him and desire to know Him in such a way that He's now close and precious to your heart? That's what He's looking for. So then you have the unhealthy fear, okay? The unhealthy fear. And the unhealthy fear, sad to say, as deep as it might go, or as much as you may be able to see it on people's faces, so many people live in it. Unhealthy fear is a fear in which somebody is consumed, whether they know it or not, with anxiety, with worry, with dread, most of the time. In fact, all the time. They live in it. They live. That's unhealthy fear, whether it's got to do with real things happening around you. If you're out in the Middle East and you're living in Syria and there's gunfights and bombs being dropped and whatever, okay, you've got a good reason to be fearful because there's some very real and physical things happening right on your doorstep, right? Okay, that doesn't give you the excuse to live in fear, though. You might say, well, Pastor, you know, I mean, let's be real. It's true. You can be in that kind of environment and still live without fear. So that comes. There's a reason why unhealthy fear is because you're maybe living in an environment where it's threatening and it's dangerous. Or you might have perceived, and I think this is where a lot of us are at, perceived threats. We worry about things we think and probably are convinced are going to happen. Did you know that I've heard it as low as 85, I've heard it as high as 97% of the things that we worry about and get all stressed out over never happens. And for the believer, even if it did, God says, my grace is what? Sufficient. That means it's ample, it's enough, it's always there when you need it. So that when you're going through something that's difficult, God's grace, peace, love, security, confidence, boldness will be there for you. It will. We scare ourselves to death by thinking, you know what? Because that's what fear does. It gives us a sense that we're going to be forsaken. That we're going to be forsaken. Fear comes in all kinds of shapes and sizes. Did you notice that? That word in 1 Peter talks about temptations, poiklos, and it's where we get our English word polka dot. Polka dots. That's an interesting word, right? Polka dots. You've seen them. They're big. They're small. They're all kinds of size. That's how our trials come. You know that? In all shapes and sizes. Okay. Our fears come in all shapes and sizes. And there's, folks, listen, there's always consequences to our fears. There is. For example, when you're fearful of what others think of you, what do you usually do? You back off. You become a recluse. You don't want to be around people. Because you know what? You've become so paranoid that everybody you meet, they're talking behind your back about you. And that's what, so you know what? You just say, well, you know what? The best way to avoid this, not to be around very many people. Except the people I really know and trust. But even then, what are they saying? What did he mean by that? And you start to be an in-between-the-lines reader. Okay? Or when you're fearful of not having enough, if somehow, you know, the threat that's coming down on you is attacking your survival, and you think that, you know what, I'm not going to have enough now, what do you usually do? The natural response to that, the ungodly response, is to become selfish. To become selfish. To get as much as I can and don't give anything away because I'm going to need it. If you're fearful of the future, what happens? What's the consequence of that? You've got no peace, no joy, no confidence. The very things the enemy came to steal, kill, and destroy. Our confidence, our joy in the Lord, amen? When we're worried about the future, when we're anxious about tomorrow, which Jesus said, guess what? Don't. You can't add anything to it. We lose our peace. We lose our joy. What kind of testimony is that? What kind of testimony are you, the church, that Jesus is the answer? He is the truth, the way, and the life. But yet you're walking around cowering in fear, worried about your next little morsel and your piece of bread. What kind of testimony must that look like? So when you're fearful about dealing with emotional pain, how am I going to deal with the death in my life of my, you know, loved one? The emotional pain of being ridiculed and hurt and left for forsaken, you know, by others, that kind of thing. What do people do with that? There's a consequence to that, too. If you're fearful of that, usually you'll turn to something to make yourself feel better. Drugs and alcohol. Sexuality, those kinds of things. Things that are going to give me a little bit of an instant fleshly lift that only leave you dry and empty after. When you're fearful of those who perhaps are different from you and don't hold your same view, you begin to develop prejudice. You begin to develop hate and bitterness toward others who are different. Can't. All unhealthy fears, folks, have their consequences. And fear wants nothing more than to do this, to consume you and to control you. Fear wants nothing more than to consume and control. It blackmails you from living the life of Jesus Christ. It robs you of the joy, and the abundant life that Jesus Christ has for you. He never said that it would just be easy. He never said that following after me, you're not going to have to pick up your cross. You're not going to have to deny self. You're not going to have trials and tribulations. He never said that. But he said it would be worth it. He said that it would all eventually work out for your good. I promise you. So fear is a double-edged sword. It can save us on one hand, right? Healthy fear. Or it can destroy us on the other hand if we choose to live in unhealthy fear. But Paul encourages us with this morning in our text. And instead of a spirit of unhealthy fear, he's telling Timothy, he's telling us here at Stony Brook this morning, you have been given the spirit of, not fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Those three things, folks, God knew we would need living this life. Power, not just a power that I muster up, but his power, his divine power. Love, not just our love that we kind of build and hope that, you know, it comes to a place where I can start to like somebody I really don't like. His love, his divine love, and a sound mind that keeps my heart and mind in Christ Jesus. Amen? Amen. Let's just look at it. Power. Paul said, Timothy, God has given you a spirit of power. Folks, there's some exciting news I'm about to give to you. That word power, in the Greek is dunamis. You probably have come across that word before. It is also, listen, it is also the word that Jesus gave the disciples in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, where he said, and you will receive power, dunamis power, when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. Not just when you read the word, not just when you pray and fellowship and do all the, but when the Holy Spirit fills your inner being, you will be a powerful individual. Where fear and doubt has no place. Gone are the days that you walk in fear. If you've got the power of the Holy Spirit living, and by the way, it is the same power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead. Look at Romans 8:11. And if the Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead is living within you, He who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through His Spirit who lives in you. It is the same Spirit, the same power, the same dunamis that raised Christ from the dead, folks, that we partake of and have living within us. There's nothing you can't do according to His will. Nothing. And Paul is reminding Timothy, don't forget that dunamis power that is within you. And folks, I know what you're thinking now. Well, as I think about other Christians, well, don't think about other Christians, whether or not they're living in the power of God or not. That's not the point here. The point here is that you can. Because the Word says that if you've invited the Holy Spirit in, you've asked Christ to forgive you, and you've asked that, then God's Spirit dwells within you. That same Spirit. That's how men of God that you read about and hear about are able to do the things they do, through the power of the Holy Spirit. That is the power that we have. Not the spirit of fear, but the Spirit, the Holy Spirit power. The world wants to give you the spirit of fear. God wants to give you His Spirit, His Holy Spirit, His Spirit that is enabling you to be greater than he that's in the world. You and Him together will always make a majority, no matter where you go, no matter what you face. Always, always. Because of that power, it's the same power that's been from ancient days and is still here today. Folks, if you are experiencing fear, you have to ask yourself, am I abiding in the very power of the Holy Spirit that is free to me upon the asking, upon the desire, upon the heart that thirsts after God? Fill me with that kind of power, oh God. And He will. And so Timothy is being blessed here. He also said, Paul, not only has God given you a spirit of power, but a spirit of love. Amen. 1 John uses the same word here, love, as Paul does when he tells Timothy that he has the spirit of love within him. We could go on. There's a sermon in this, you know, right here alone. But do you know how powerful love is? That when you grasp hold of the fact that that the love that God intends for me to have, to be able to love those who are unlovely, even in my enemies, is not your love. You can't muster that up. You can't make that happen. Maybe it can be a good show for a time, but guess what? It's going to let you down because it's not divine love. The kind of love that he's talking about here, the kind of love in 1 John 4:18 where it says there is no fear in love. No fear in love, but what? Perfect love drives out all fear. What kind of love is he talking about? Is he talking about phileo love? The kind of love that you have for a fellow brother, you know, a friend, a real deep friend? No. Is he talking about eros kind of love, a passionate love, a sexual love that you have with one person? No, he's not talking about that. What kind of love is he talking about here? Agape love. It's agape love. That's a love that we rarely understand, folks, I believe. We get the first two down, right? We're getting pretty good at phileo and eros love, okay? The agape love is a love that only can be known through God by God. As we humble ourselves, He disperses upon us His love. It is the same love that Jesus had for you and for me to go to the cross. That same love for the Father. It is a love that is beyond comprehension. And folks, He's not just saying, well, I'm the only one that has that. God, because we are created in His image, wants us to have His same kind of love. He wants us to be able to love like He loves. Amen? And when you love like that, that's called a perfect love. And when you have perfect love, guess what there isn't? Fear. There is no fear. You know why? Because a perfect love trusts completely, is comfortable, has peace. God says, that's the love that I have for you and you can have for others. You know, there's been some, can't think of one right off the bat, but so many examples of Christians who've maybe been apprehended by violence and whatever, held captive perhaps. Oh, in fact, now I don't know this young man, and I don't know what his relationship is with God, but there was a young man, remember we prayed for a young man just a few days ago in Haiti who was abducted? No? Well, okay. And we started praying. And I can only hope that within that young man, first of all, they let him go, which is unheard of. A national, they let him go. Maybe an American or a foreigner, they might think about it if they, you know, whatever. But the national, they actually let him go. He was the son of the eye doctor that Patty deals with. And so he called her and asked all of us to pray. And so we did. But they let him go. And I've heard so many other stories where, you know, their captors, those who've abducted this little tooth, I can't wait to get rid of it. They've abducted them, and they've seen nothing but the love of Jesus Christ in them. And it doesn't mean sometimes these people, you know, that are abducted and taken for, you know, for ransom and that kind of thing, aren't necessarily just ones walking around just love. It's the grace that God gives that individual, that young man perhaps, and they see that. And these people are captured by and overwhelmed and overcome by the very agape love of God. Folks, it is powerful, agape love. And that's what He has given to us. That's what Jesus had in His heart, the spirit of agape love, when He marched to the cross. You think it was a spirit of fear? No way. But of love. Because love always overcomes fear and evil. Amen? It does. I wish in this world we all understood that. Love. It's too easy not to, right? How many of us know? Isn't it easier to be bitter? Isn't it easier to hold people hostage in our hearts rather than love? But that, even though you're doing that and you feel like you're gaining ground, you're never gaining ground. Only love sets free. And God knows that. Paul wraps it up here with giving us a spirit, not of fear, but what? Of power and of love. And some verses say self-discipline. I like to think of it as sound mind, and I know that's what the King James does, but it sort of means the same. And I think in the context of fear of what we're talking about here, sound mind really fits. Because how many in this room have difficulty sometimes with keeping, and I'm not saying you're close to insanity or on the cusp of it, but keeping a sound mind, keeping your mind fixed on what you know is true. How many are feeling that right now? How many are struggling with a sound mind right this moment, okay? Because we're human. And that's what fear does. That's why I like that term, sound mind, because fear wants to undo your mind. That's what fear wants to do. Fear wants to take your mind for a ride down gloom and doom and despair and forsakenness. That's what fear wants to do. Fear wants to play games with your mind. Fear wants to say, guess what? No, you know how this is going to end? You're going to be left alone. You're going to be forsaken. That's what fear says. Fear wants you and me to have a mindset that is filled with dread and anxiety and worry. And Paul said, Timothy, God's not giving you that. You have the power, you have the self-discipline to correct your thinking. You do. God doesn't make us think anything. He's given us a mind to think. Paul says, think upon these things. Think where Christ sits at the right hand of God. All of these thoughts. But we've got to bring our thinking under control. We have to. And that's what having a sound mind is. And so God gives us the means to be able to do that. And I love, it's one of my favorite verses there in Isaiah 26:3. Listen to these two verses. Isaiah 26:3. I will keep him in what? Perfect peace. That's a sound mind. I will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on me because he trusts in the Lord. I will keep him in a perfect peace, not just a peace, a perfect peace, a godly peace, the personification of peace himself, God. I will keep him there whose mind is fixed and stayed and centered on me. That's his promise. Folks, that's what it takes. How do I have that sound mind? I keep my thoughts and my affections. I grab hold, first of all, the control of my racing mind, of where it wants to go. Because it's weird, right? You can be in the middle of a prayer meeting and all of a sudden have these unbelievably ungodly thoughts, right? You can. You're having what Stanley used to call a satanic attack. You can have that. But we've got the power to bring it back, to bridle it, to take every thought captive, right? Every thought captive to the chief, to the captain. And that's what he's saying here, that if you keep your mind fixed on me, focused on me, centered on me, I will keep you in a perfect peace. That's the key. It's essential. And then Paul writes, you know, the same thing. He echoes the same thing in Philippians 4:7. And the peace of God, which surpasses what? All understanding, that fathoms the mind. A peace. That's not the world's peace. He says, the peace that surpasses all understanding will what? Guard your hearts in what? Your mind. Your mind. You'll have a sound mind. Isn't that what we need, a sound mind? Isn't that what we need is power from the Holy Spirit? Love, the very love, the agape love of God, amen? And of a sound mind that fixes its thoughts and affections upon Christ is the remedy for fear. Is the remedy for fear. Folks, there's no shortage of things to be afraid of today. Some people let them get it to a point where they will not leave their little residence. And that's what fear will do. Inevitably, it'll just burrow you down and shape and carve you down to this little tiny piece of humanity that is afraid of everything. Not the way God intended us to live, amen? Should we take precautions? Absolutely. Should we be concerned? Yes. But we're not talking, fear is not just mere concern, right? Concern's okay. Concern is wisdom. Concern says, I want to check this out before I go ahead and step out and do something, you know, whatever, I want to evaluate it all. That's what concern is. Fear is what too many of God's people are living in. And God said, let it not be so, because I've not given you that spirit, but just the opposite. I've given you a spirit of power and of love and of a sound mind, and you can walk in confidence in this life no matter what. Amen. Amen. My time is gone. We're going to bow our heads. Heavenly Father, every single one of us, I believe, have not healthy fears, well, of course we do, but unhealthy ones as well. Things that strike a chord within our heart and soul, that God, that we try to bury. And sometimes we're successful at burying it, but it will always resurrect itself. Others of us are not too successful in burying. We actually are living with it front and center every single day. God, it's a life of dread, a life of anxiety, a life worrying about what's going to happen. And folks, as your heads are bowed and your eyes are closed, first of all, don't deny those things, those thoughts, maybe that which is in your heart. That's the first and most necessary key to living and overcoming fear and fearing not. Admit that it's there to God. And say to Him this morning, God, would you free me? Would I, oh God, as I come to you, be able to receive that power and that love and that sound thinking, oh God, to help me in this life? So that, God, I know ultimately you are in control, oh God. And I'm not going to try to bite off more than I can chew by worrying about things that I have no business worrying about. I can only do what I can do, oh God, what you've set before me, my daily bread, to do what I can do, and that's it. And Father, you will handle the rest. You surely will. And so, Father, I'm here this morning, and I'm struggling with fear. I'm struggling with that anxiety. I'm struggling with feeling incompetent. I'm feeling like, God, that things are happening around me that I can't control. I don't seem to have that self-confidence. I feel insecure. God, we know that there's a world out there that gives us every reason to feel that. But God, that doesn't mean that we have to live that way and carry that condition in our heart. Free us now, oh God, we're praying, as our hearts are bowed before you. Free us from any anxiety, any undue stress. Free us unto a life that is abundant with joy and confidence and peace and power. Father, we pray. We need it now more than ever. And so, God, we ask and we thank you because you hear our prayer and you love us. I pray for every heart here this morning, oh God, every heart. Every one of us deal and struggle with some things. Father, I pray that as we bring it before you, you will show us how to overcome it. You will give us, oh God, all that we need to do that. And we praise you and thank you in Jesus' name. Would you just stand this morning? I want to challenge you this morning to do just that. That when you hear something, some kind of news, or just a feeling that kind of just comes up in your heart, sometimes triggers that we don't even realize are happening, things we see, and then all of a sudden it's triggering an emotion within us. And so this triggers. We're going to say to God, God, right now I'm feeling anxious. I'm feeling a little worried, oh God. This is something that I really don't have control over, but I know that you do. And I'm asking you to give me a peace. Remind me of the power I have. Remind me of the love that I have. Remind me of the sound mind that you said is mine in Christ Jesus. I want to encourage you to do that. Put this stuff to work, folks. Make it applicable in your life. And you will see the strength and the salvation of God in a great way. Amen. Heavenly Father, thank you for our time. Thank you, God, for bringing this to my heart, oh God, this series on fear, oh God. And there are many people perhaps who would say that they're not fearful, and that's wonderful, but we not to deceive ourselves, oh God, because there are things. And so, God, I pray that you would just help us, oh God, to see that you are the way, the truth, and the life in every way. And that, God, that you will be with us and walk with us in strength and might. And we know that, Father, we are aware of your presence everywhere we go. And we love you and we thank you for that. We thank you that we are your people. This is our church. And so, God, we give it to you. Go with us now, we pray, in strength and in might. And all of God's people said, amen and amen. Hallelujah. 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 We love you, Father. We thank you, Lord.